الله صلى الله عليه وسلم الإيمان يماني والحكمة يماني.
Daniel, how are you doing?
Hello, sir. Yeah, I'm doing very well, thank you. It's been a while.
It has been a while. It's been a while indeed. Ricky, now, when was the last time we spoke together on camera like this?
Well, it would, I suppose, be your debate review. Was there anything since then?
I don't think so. Kovefef, isn't it?
Yeah, I mean, would it be the Easter last year?
Was it that long ago?
I'm trying to think. I mean, we did that show on the crucifixion resurrection. Is there anything since that?
Yeah. I think you're right, actually. Damn, that is a long time. I didn't realize it's been that long. Wow. Time has flown. How are you?
Yeah, very good. Thank the Lord. Yeah. And yourself and your family?
Alhamdulillah, everyone's good.
Good.
Everyone's good. Yeah. So tell me. I mean, obviously, as you know, you already know what the show's about and everything. I've explained it to you before.
So yeah, you said it twice. So yeah. Well, I mean, obviously I'm saving a lot of stuff for the debate that you challenged me to over a year and a half ago. So
yeah.
There's some places I won't go. I'm also hoping at some point I might be able to do something specific on Tawheed and on the Quran's view of Jesus, but those are kind of topics on their own. I think we did touch on one subject once that we never really took off with. And as far as I know, Al-Waqidi is the only narrator for the hadith that you referred to about breastfeeding. So I don't know if you'd like to try to explain that. The hadith in Sahih Muslim obviously are pretty well known, as they should be. But
Well, let's have a. So what is the argument? What's the claim? And what are you trying to get from this hadith?
Well, according to my recollection of the relevant hadith, you have a man who is concerned because he is spending time away from home with his work, mm-hmm. and his wife is going to be in the company of another man alone while he is gone, and this is something that's concerning to him. So he takes this problem that he faces with his wife to Muhammad. And Muhammad's solution is, first of all, to say that she needs to suckle the man 10 times, and then he will be like a son to her. And
it's not 10 times, but
It was later changed to 5 times, right?
That's a different hadith altogether. That is a different ruling. The hadith that you're referring to now is a very specific state for that person only. It is not something that is a general rule for everyone. So, for example, if I had a man being in my home alone with my wife, I couldn't just say to her, you know, suckle him 10 times and that's it, it'll be fine. This is not a general rule. And besides, the man that you're referring to, he grew up in the household. So he passed the age of puberty at that point. So they were already as a family, but because he wasn't blood related, that's why that was done. And it wasn't direct breastfeeding. This is not implied anywhere in the hadith, but what I'm still trying to understand, what is it, why this specific hadith, how does this challenge Islam in any way? What are you trying to get at exactly?
Well, the point would be that Muhammad is giving bad advice, which is part of, it was at least part of the Quran before it was removed one way or another. We can talk about how that happened, but that's a slightly different issue. The Quran is actually quoting something which is not.
Why was it bad advice? First and foremost, you're saying it was bad advice. Why is it bad advice?
Because it wouldn't have the effect that Muhammad was suggesting that it would, right?
Which was, what was the effect?
So that he would no longer be attracted to her.
No, that's not the effect. What is it? What does breastfeeding? What does the breastfeeding actually do in terms of a relationship?
In what context? I mean, there's some very different contexts that we could be discussing this in. So it's not going to be exactly the same in every situation.
No, but this is what it is, right? So obviously, like I said, this stream is built up. I'm not here to make the argument for you. So you're coming with this hadith and you already misunderstand. The first thing is you've conflated it with a second hadith regarding the 10 and the 5 breastfeeding. So you made that conflation. Then you were talking about it being a bad advice, but you don't even know the consequences of or the effect of that breast or that suckling. It's actually not suckling. That's not how the hadith actually addresses it, but the giving of milk. Okay. So you've already got a few misconceptions here. So if you're bringing up this hadith, you must know what the effect is and what was being achieved by doing so.
Well, do we agree on what the issue was that was being brought to Muhammad was?
No, because you've misunderstood the issue, right? Because you think that the issue is an issue of the man being attracted to his wife. That is not the issue.
Okay, so if we start from the beginning, at what point do you think I'm going wrong when I'm repeating what the hadith says? The man was concerned because he was going away from home for a significant length of time. Mm-hmm. And there was another man who would be in the company of his wife while he was gone. Is this right? Am I correct so far?
Let's bring up the hadith so that there's no conjecture. Let's bring up the hadith. Do you have it at hand or can you find it?
I don't think it would be difficult to find.
No. If it's the hadith that I think, you know, just give me the reference and we'll bring it up. It's not a problem.
Yeah, I'll just grab it.
Yeah, that's fine.
I mean, I assume we're both thinking about the one when he objects saying, well, she objects saying that he has a beard, right? That's the original one. And then obviously you've got the talk about the 5 and the 10 breastfeedings being abrogated and then the
I think you're still conflating between two hadith.
Yeah, those are two different ones. I mean, there's many hadith about this, right? There's an entire book of suckling in Sahih Muslim.
Yes, there is. But these two are not related.
Just finding it. I've got a list of hadith here, and we are. And I got so much stuff saved on my phone. Embryology, oral preservation. Ah, here we are. Page 221.
Inshallah, hardly.
Yeah, just wish this stuff was more searchable in the version I have. Anyway, the Qadiani is leaving you alone while I'm looking for this.
I've left them alone.
You left them alone.
Yeah, no, I've done my bit. When it comes to the writings of Mirza Ghulam, it's not my field. I don't know Urdu. So to be able to access the original texts, it's not my field. So left that to the brothers who know Urdu.
What's your take on Kadyrov?
Who?
Kadyrov, the Chechen fellow.
Who's that?
Basically the leader of the Muslims in Chechnya who are fighting for Putin.
I have no idea. I haven't looked at that.
Fair enough.
Mm.
Women are right section at least.
Wa alaykum as-salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Ah, here we are. Okay. So we have, for example, Sahih Muslim
1453.
Book 17, Hadith 33.
Sorry, Sahih Muslim 1453,
yeah? Yep, that's right.
Okay, let's have a look.
I wonder if I can cancel. I wonder if I can share my screen for you.
Hmm.
I'm not sure if I can or not.
So I've
got the whole list of different hadiths here. So
this is the hadith.
Mm-hmm.
That we are both thinking of. In terms of the beard, when you said beard, I did make a weird face because I don't remember that being in the hadith. And I was correct, it's not in the hadith. So this is the short version.
Yeah, there's a bunch of different ones.
Yeah, so this is the short version. So, as mentioned, with this hadith, let's see, 1453b, this is the same hadith. So if you look at 1453b, it mentions the purpose.
It would remove what is there, the expression of disgust in the face of Abu Hudayfa.
Yeah, but the purpose here was, it says, if you look further up, it says, suckle him and you would become unlawful for him, right?
Mm-hmm.
So the purpose of this was to essentially make him a mahram, someone that she cannot marry,
right?
And that is what happens through suckling. So that is the purpose. And of course, yeah, so you were partially right, you know, because Abu Hudayfa, he didn't want there to be any attraction, right? But the purpose of suckling is to make someone a non-mahram. A mahram, right? Someone that is now unlawful to marry,
mm-hmm.
right? And this is why, you know, this is partly the reason why whenever a mother breastfeeds her children, they become mahrams, right? Or likewise, you know, in terms of marriage and everything, like you got various things that would cause people to be unlawful to you for marriage. Okay, so that is the purpose. But still, going back to the question, how was it bad advice? You're saying it was bad advice. How was it bad advice?
Well, generally, this isn't something that has the effect that he was hoping for, right?
But what was the effect? What was the effect he was hoping for?
To lessen the chances of her committing adultery with him.
Did it achieve?
How would you know?
Well, it says it in the hadith, doesn't it? So it says here, suckle him and you would become unlawful for him. So therefore, she can't marry him. She can't marry that guy, right? So that is the first thing that was achieved. Secondly, all right, she actually mentions herself, right? and said, so I suckled him, and what was there in the heart of Abu Hudayfa disappeared. So his worry of that happening disappeared. So it was achieved.
And that is according to a woman who would have been stoned if she had have committed adultery with him and admitted it, right?
No, there's nothing here about committing adultery.
Wait, I'm wondering, like, are we saying that, what is the purpose of it if it isn't to avoid her committing adultery with him while her husband is away? What is the point if that's not the intention?
No, so this wasn't the intention. It was just a fear of Abu Hudayfa, right? Abu Hudayfa thought that this man, now that he has attained puberty, okay, mm-hmm. and yes. he entered our house freely. I, however, perceive something. So this is a worry, not of, what do you call it, of the wife of Abu Hudayfa as well. So she had this issue as well. She saw this fear in her husband that, you know, and this is just, you know, a husband that has protective jealousy over his wife. And she went to the, and what do you call it? She went to the Prophet, peace be upon him, and asked for a solution, right? So it mentioned Salim has attained puberty. So this is the man, and he understands what they understand, i.e. intimacy. And he enters our house freely. However, I perceive that something rankles in the heart of Abu Hudayfa. So she's aware of her husband's feelings, right? She can sense it. So she comes to Rasulullah, and Rasulullah gives her this advice, and the advice achieves all that it needs to achieve. It's in the hadith. So when you say it's a bad advice because it doesn't achieve what it's meant to achieve, it did, and it says so in the hadith.
But you think that was just for that one case that it would ever have that effect?
Yes, or... and this is known throughout Islamic literature that is a very specific case, and that is all it is. It is not a general rule that any woman who's now, or any man who now has fear that a man is in his house, then can be suckled in order to become unlawful to his wife. This is not a general rule.
So you also have a hadith in Malik's Muwatta, which actually, I'm probably going to butcher the pronunciation here, but it says that Yahya related to me from Malik, from Nafi, that Safiya bint Abu Ubaid told him that Hafsa sent Asim ibn Abdullah ibn Sa'd to her sister Fatima bint Umar ibn al-Khattab for her to suckle him 10 times so that he could come in and see her. She did it, so he used to come in and see her. So it doesn't seem like it's just a one-off case, judging by that.
No, so this case, okay, this is very specific to Salim, okay? Now, what's the narration? What's the Muwatta Malik? Do you have a number for this?
Yeah, that's chapter 30, section 1, number 8.
Section 1, number 8. Let me just try and find that.
Now, you might call this speculation, but I would suggest that the original case with Abu Hanifa's wife, sorry, I'm getting the name a bit wrong, would be setting a precedent that this other lady was following. But if you want to treat it as two completely independent situations, in addition to when you have the verse of breastfeeding 10 times that was then abrogated to 5, I don't know. I guess you'd have to explain them independently from one another.
But going While I'm looking for this, what I'm saying to you is, how does this falsify Islam?
Well, it's, you would say it's contrary to the fitra. I think that would be the way to express it in Islamic terminology. But I think we know from the way that human nature is that this is not something that is in keeping with what works with man's natural tendencies.
Explain further.
Well, a woman exposing herself to a man is not something which tends to lessen attraction, but rather to increase it, for example, right? And that would apply as well with this kind of physical contact.
Well, so what you have here is an assumption that there is physical contact.
Well, it's not an assumption, because it actually says that she should suckle him so many times, or whichever, depending on which hadith we're looking at. Now, where the dispute comes in is if you want to suggest that she used some kind of a cup in between or something. And the only source that you have for that would be generally rejected when it's a independent source on its own without further backing, which is from Al-Waqidi, which is where my original question came from. So we shouldn't pick and choose what's reliable from Al-Waqidi. If, as an individual, he's reliable in the absence of further evidence, there's a lot of other material coming from him that Muslims generally reject. So there would be a question of consistency that needed to be resolved at that point.
Okay, so hold on a second. Mm-hmm. What you're saying is, wait, how's Al-Waqidi connected? You're saying it because he's the only narrator of the first one.
Al-Waqidi is the only narrator of the hadith that claims that the milk was put into a cup to be drank instead of being suffered.
Oh, right. Okay, so in terms of the...
And I know you have appealed to that explanation in the past, and mm-hmm. I've looked somewhat into the reliability of Al-Waqidi as a narrator and how he's viewed in terms of hadith. So that would...
No, but he's not... He's not a hadith... Mm-hmm. What do you call it? He doesn't specialize in hadith.
Yeah, sure.
We all know that, but the explanation of it being into a cup is widely known throughout, you know, any Islamic source that you go into, they will always mention that. It's not just Al-Waqidi that mentions this. Any person that exegetes this this hadith would say the same, whether it's a Nawawi or Ibn Hajar, they all mention this.
Are there any other primary sources for who have chains of narration saying that that was the case?
This wouldn't be a primary source, because obviously you have the people who commentate on this from mm-hmm. you know, from their teachers and so forth. So as mentioned, these commentators all acknowledge that this is the case, that this is done into a cup.
And the basis of that would be what then? What are they basing that on?
Well, because it's haram. Right, it's impermissible to, do that, and it's indecent. So it's, for example,
right. So this would be the argument against Islam from that Islam is promoting something indecent, as you put it.
Well, that would only be the case if there was physical contact, which there isn't, right? And there isn't any indication that anything was seen. So even if it was put into a cup, it wasn't like it was done in front of the person, like the, you know, the veil was lifted and, you know, the milk was squeezed in front of an individual. This is not the case. Okay. Likewise, so for example, when people talk about Banu Qurayda, right, and they say about how the men knew that the boys reached puberty, they immediately assume something indecent. They immediately assume that the only way they were able to determine that is if they looked at their below the belt. But there are other places that you can look at in order to determine that a boy has attained puberty. The face, we start to grow facial hair. The armpits, we start to grow hair there, right? There are certain other indications, but people tend to think in indecent things. So it's
I
not really...
there was actually a hadith that said that.
There isn't a hadith that mentions that it was that they look below the belt.
There isn't. Okay.
It just mentions that they were checked to see if they reached puberty. So this insinuation comes from the critics. It doesn't come from our sources. So if you actually come and mention, for example, a hadith like this, and you want to display that there is actual indecency being committed, then you would have to find a source within Islamic, you know, with like Islamic sources that actually states this, and you wouldn't find it. So this is why it's very important to understand what our sources actually say and what it's meant by suckling. Because people hear suckling and they immediately assume there's physical contact.
Well, this would be the issue, right? Because you're saying that all of the early tafsir, all of the tafsir really, early or otherwise, are saying that it was put into a cup. The reason they're saying that is because it would be indecent if that wasn't the case, right?
Yeah, so the Prophet, peace be upon him, will never command something indecent, right? And the law is already clear, right?
But this would be the issue. If you're beginning with the assumption that he would never command something indecent, that is causing you to reinterpret it away from its plain meaning.
This is not an assumption. You'd have to tell me where the assumption is.
Couldn't command anything indecent. That's the assumption.
Why is that an assumption?
Because you don't have any evidence for it.
Okay, so can you think of something indecent that the Prophet, peace be upon him, commanded?
How about muta?
It's not indecent.
It's not.
No. When it was permissible, it wasn't indecent.
Is it indecent
because
now?
It's indecent now. Because it's been made impermissible. So the thing is, this is another thing, and I actually had this conversation on Sunday with regards to intimacy and the lawfulness of intimacy. If something is, if a particular act of intimacy is made lawful, then it is not indecent, right? But if it's made impermissible, then it becomes indecent and prohibited, right? So that is how Muslims understand the rules of intimacy, right? And what the permissibility of intimacy. So again, if you're going to work within our paradigm, then you can't say that muta was indecent, because that was commanded by, it was allowed by Allah up until Khaybar, and then it was made impermissible.
So judging by that, how can you say that the adult breastfeeding would be indecent if your Prophet
if there was,
they have just made it halal, in which case it was
no. So if there was physical contact, then yes, that would be indecent, because this is not something that Islam commands, right? It goes outside of that. So Islam forbids physical contact between non-mahrams. So if you are a non-mahram up to the point of suckling, before you suckle, you'd have physical contact before you suckle. Therefore, that would be an indecent thing to do. It'd be haram. So to do something that is not haram, you can't have that. And this is sound reasoning.
So I found the hadith regarding the Battle of Quraiza, and it does explicitly say that it was determined that way.
Which hadith?
Jami'at Tirmidhi, 1584.
Jameer.
Do you want me to put it in the chat? I do have it.
Wait, was it 15? What was it? Sorry. 1584. Okay. It says pubic hair.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Okay. So, it's pubic hair. Hold on. Come on. You and I are now both grown men. Is pubic hair only below the belt?
Not necessarily.
Exactly. So what? This is the question. This is the question. Why is it? And I'm obviously, you and I were good friends and everything. I know you know that this is not directed at you, but it tends to be the case that whenever subjects like suckling or Qurayza or Banu Qurayza come up, the first thing that enters the mind is private areas. Why is that?
Well, that is the precedent that is followed by certain groups in Iraq and Syria, right? That is the way that they determine it. This was where I first heard of it, actually.
Yeah, okay, but again, you know, I know you too. I know that you actually do a lot more research than the average person. But there is you read pubic hair and you immediately thought below the belt. Why?
Most people do, right?
No.
You don't think so?
I know so. I know so. Because people that I approach regarding these things, most of the people I've approached regarding this particular hadith about Banu Qurayza, they actually think of the armpit.
Really?
That's pubic. Yeah, that's pubic hair.
Well, that's... I mean, it's what you might call anecdotal evidence, but the first time that I actually heard of this hadith, it was from a ex-Muslim lady who, this was the first thing that she saw that caused her to leave Islam without reading anything outside. She read the practice of certain groups in Iraq and Syria. She read the hadith and she made the connection without
but this is now source.
I mean, it is anecdotal evidence, you know. I can't bring her here, you can't talk to her, she's only one person.
No. I trust in what you're saying. I trust what you're saying. Well, what I'm saying is, what she's done, from what you have told me, what she's done is take a hadith and compared it to something that is currently happening in Iraq or Syria or some point in not that long ago, right? But we are talking about a 7th century event now. We gotta keep it to, and we're talking about the companions of the Prophet, peace be upon him. They're not gonna go around and pulling trousers down. This is not what Islam teaches. If you look at these teachings of Islam, guarding modesty, guarding, like, even men, we have our own hijab. We have our own hijab, right? We are commanded to cover from above our navel to below our knee. That has to always be covered. So and this is related to the companions, of course, right? Radwan Allah alayhum. So the idea that a religion, that a prophet who teaches the utmost modesty to guard the private parts of the believing men and the believing women, to go around pulling the trousers down to check for puberty, that makes no sense. And there is no evidence within the Islamic corpus to suggest that. It only appears in the minds of certain individuals. Okay? And some would say perverted. But, and like I said, I'm not directing this at you. I've known you a long time. I know you're not like this. But one thing that I would always, I have asked you this before, Daniel, you know, do what you always do. Look at the sources, okay? Because I love it when you do that. When you start going away from the sources, you start falling into the things that other people have done, which they have no basis for. And you are an evidence-based individual. Even when it comes to your own faith, you like to look at the evidence. You don't like to make conjecture. So I ask you likewise to do the same with Islam. There is nothing in the hadith in Jami' al-Tirmidhi that mentions specifically or explicitly that the way they checked for pubic hair was below the belt. Can you concede that?
Yeah, it literally just says pubic hair, and that would be, for many people, arguably for the original audience, that's arguable. But for most people, that is the most natural reading of the text.
Okay. Again, we're looking at the evidence, not what's in the mind of people. Again, you could, you can say that some people, their minds just wander into places that they shouldn't wander, right? For me, what is the evidence? The evidence is that Islam teaches the utmost modesty, right? To the point that a woman her ankle can't be shown, okay? A man has to be covered from above the navel, so midway through his stomach, down to below his kneecap, right? And that is only to guard his private area. This is in the Quran, that believing men and believing women guard their private parts. So why are we going to assume that the best of the Muslims, who are the companions of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, are then going to disregard the utmost modesty and start pulling trousers down to check for puberty when there are other means?
I think there is a key distinction here, though. And that is, as you say, the believing men and the believing women.
Yes.
Same standards are not required by Islam for slaves and so forth. And I'm not aware in the original sources that there is similar standards that are laid down for the unbelievers who are within Islam, right? And I think, I mean, you can say that people are contradicting Islam historically, but historically there hasn't been the same requirements for modesty for non-Muslims as there are for Muslims within an Islamic state.
So I want to understand here. Are you talking about in terms of the Muslims treating the non-Muslims or just non-Muslims as a group under Islamic rule?
I'm talking about, for example, the kind of clothing or lack of it that slaves would have when they were being sold by one Muslim to another if the slave was a non-Muslim.
No, so this is where you're wrong, because there are hadith that mention that you clothe your slaves with what you have, right? So if you have a slave, a female slave, and you have a wife, she'll be clothed in the same way your wife is clothed. This is a standard, right? So because Islam is the religion for mankind, and part of da'wah is not just talking to people about it, it's to act on it. And this is why Islam encourages the Muslims and commands the Muslims actually to feed their slaves as they are fed, to clothe them as they are clothed, and to find ways to to free them, either by buying their freedom or freeing them. And this is why they even Rasulullah even mentioned that something along the lines, I can't remember the exact wording, but hit your slave like you hit your wife. But what does that actually mean? It means don't hit your slave, because you're not meant to hit your wife, right? So don't do that, right? So you can't even hit the slave, right? Another hadith where he mentions, don't even call your slave abd, right? Because you yourself are the slave of Allah, so don't call him your slave, right? It's encouraged to call slaves by their names, right? So you have all of this, and slaves, they're not Muslims, are they? They tend to be non-Muslims, and yet that's the treatment that we are to give them. So this is something that is also not true.
So I'm thinking about the verses of hijab.
The verses of hijab.
Does it not say that that is to? I think I'm going to have to plug my phone in soon. Does it not say that that is to make a distinction between the believing women and the unbelieving women?
Of course, it does. And it does make a distinction, because a woman who is covered, you can recognize her from a woman that is uncovered. This is not to say that we force slaves to wear a hijab. At the end of the day, if they are non-Muslim, they are free to dress how they want. It's their religion. Whatever the religion they're upon, they are free to do so. How? Because Islam incorporates. It understands that there will be times where Muslims and non-Muslims will live in the same sphere. So, you know, even when you look at the Islamic expansion and the conquests and stuff, when the Muslims conquered a territory, the Jews and the Christians, they were allowed to live by their own laws. They were allowed to drink, they were allowed to eat pork, they were allowed to dress how they wanted to dress, they were allowed to go to the churches and synagogues and stuff like that. When we say Sharia, for example, when we say Sharia law being imposed on a land, it is not to say that every single person, Muslim and non-Muslim, abides by Islamic law. Islamic law is there as an option, right? And this is why you see the Jews in the late Middle Ages, they would come to Islamic courts rather than their own synagogues because they found Islamic courts had better judgment. But it wasn't incumbent upon them to do so. So Islam, the laws of Islam incorporate all of mankind. However, also gives the religious groups, primarily the Jews and the Christians, freedom of their own religion. Okay? And obviously, because you guys are our cousins in faith, you are the people of the book, you have been honored as such, right? By Allah in the Quran, despite being known to us as disbelievers, yet you are still honored in that respect as the people of the book. But again, what I'm trying to get back at the end of the day, this stream is meant to is for you to prove Islam false. How and you know very well, in order to prove Islam false, you'd have to target something more fundamental than what you've brought today. And what do you call it? I've got two more guests, by the way, so I'll try and keep this maybe for another 5 minutes or so before.
Yeah, no problem. I mean, obviously, I'm saving the arguments that I choose to for a future occasion with you.
I understand. I would advise that even though we have this debate planned, not to bring it forward, because at the end of the day, me and you, we don't know how long we're going to live. And at the end of the day, this is a salvific thing. It's not something for us. It's not like a regular debate with, you know, something that's, at the end of the day, this is a salvific topic regarding the prophethood of Muhammad, peace be upon him, and everything. I would advise, if you want to bring that forward, bring it forward. At the end of the day, me and you having this debate, it's just to have a formal setting, because you and I are both busy and we start conversations and we never finish them. That is the main reason why we put these debates together, so we can actually sit down and talk about it together. But because it's a salvific issue, I'd rather if, you know, we can bring them up at various times as well. At the end of the day, you and I, we don't debate for ego or for scoring points. We debate for the truth, right? And I know that about you, and that's why I debate you. So that would be my advice. If there is something that you want to discuss regarding the prophethood of Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and actually challenge that, go for it. You know, it's not a problem. But obviously, not today, because I've got three more guests now that are going to come on, and I want to give them some time as well.
Yeah. Well, I wish you all the best for now.
Thank you very much, bro.
God bless, and talk to you again, God willing, on a future occasion.
Inshallah. Daniel, it was great to see you, my friend.
God bless. Bye for now.
Bye for now.